We have $75 from Imperial Ace. Can't wait any longer for that StarCraft run. Let's make it happen. We have $100 from Last Pirate. Need to see the StarCraft run, so here's a hundo. We have $25 from Blackout, making this donation to say that Protoss is the superior StarCraft race. Hey, and if you don't agree, donate and let me know. Yeah, we got some people agreeing in here. But hey, if you're a Terran fan, if you're a Zergling, come on. Get your donations in. Let them know that they're wrong. Or if you're Protoss, you know, get a crowd going for that too. Get your donations in and solidify that lead. We have $42 from Slytherin, donating for this amazing cause and for my Dark Templar brothers. Adun Turidas. All right, and we are ready for this run of Nuclear Throne with Fish McMuffins. Take it away.
All right, how's everyone doing? Doing good?
Okay.
All right, so this is Nuclear Throne. It's a roguelike designed by Vlambeer. Really difficult game. Do not be surprised if I die, but hopefully I don't die. That would be cool. I would definitely enjoy that a lot. We're playing Steroids. He's by far the best character for speedrunning. We'll talk about it later. This is all bosses category, which means I'm going to go about halfway into loop to fight all the loop exclusive bosses, and the run ends on Captain, which is the secret boss that triggers the secret ending. It's really difficult. So I guess we'll just jump into it. Are you ready, Couch? Ready, everyone?
All right.
Ready as I'll ever be.
Let's do it.
All right. 3, 2, 1, go. All right, so starting out, we're immediately going to do a developer-intended shortcut. It's called Oasis. If I pick up all the chests without killing too many enemies on a level, I can warp ahead a little bit, and I'll skip all the way to 3-3, and I'll skip having to play some of the areas that I have to visit and loop later anyway. Basically, the start of this run is going to be any percent for Throne. The problem with this, though, is that taking Oasis, the way that drops are seeded in this game is that depending on how many areas you visit, you get higher tier weapon drops. So by taking Oasis, I've just skipped like 6 or some odd areas, so my weapon drops are going to be really bad. So I have to deal with that for the first 5 minutes of the run or so. So we're coming up to the next boss here, Big Dog. We're going to be fighting him later, but we have to fight him now. He's just kind of a bullet sponge. He spins a predictable spiral of bullets, really not threatening at all. Just got to get him in the corner, he'll explode on death, and we clean up the level. So the way that levels work in this game, you have to kill every enemy on a floor before you can continue onwards. So there's enemies that can teleport behind me, there's enemies that can fly behind me, I can miss an enemy, I can misread a hallway. I can lose a lot of time to enemies trolling me, is basically what I'm saying. We're in Crystal Caves. I'll talk about the mutation system now. Every time I level up by collecting rads, you can see my rad canister in the top left corner. I get a selection of 4 perks, and...
Oh my god.
I can't aim. Anyway, I get a selection of 4 perks, and I basically get what I get. I have to pick whatever is optimal. There's really not that many mutations in this game that outright save time. So honestly, it's faster, if you get a bad pull, it's faster to just pick something than to sit there for 5 seconds and think about what you want. Because it's not likely that mutation is going to save you back that much time. So just pick something.
Yeah, unfortunately, the timer runs on that screen. So.
Yeah. Up next is 5-2. 5-2 has a crown vault that I need to enter. It has, I get a selection of a crown, which basically it's these items that I can pick up that have different risk and reward factors. And Crime of Curses gives me a 2 in 3 chance for every weapon chest to have a cursed weapon, which will be potentially a higher tier weapon for me. So it's kind of a way to cheese better weapons if I get lucky. And so, you know, if it's something I can do out of luck, I might as well try for it. So let's see what cursed weapons I get. I mash 6 to get Crown of Curses as fast as possible. And the first hard wall of this game for many casual players is this boss right here, Little Hunter. He is very random and he is very spammy, but I kind of cleared out the level beforehand, so I can kind of just peek him and fire some bolts into him. He dies in 5 bolts, I believe, with... Oh, 6, okay. 7? 7. There it is. We found it. We found a number. So yeah, he's down, and the rest of pre-loop is pretty much safe from here. Famous last words.
Yep.
But until then, I guess we can talk about some of the mutations I picked up already. I've taken Last Wish. I'll talk about that when that's relevant, but that'll let me visit a secret area later. I just got... This is actually a really good cursed weapon, so the Crown of Curses has already paid off for me. But anyway, I also have Strong Spirit, which will save me for 1 fatal hit per run, or not per run, per level, which is really good for safety. It's a marathon. I'm taking that absolutely. And then I have Euphoria, which will slow down bullets. It's not great, but it's nice safety for some bosses. I have Thronebutt as well. Third Thronebutt is hard. Basically, Thronebutts in this game, they buff your character's active ability. And for Thronebutt, whenever I'm dual wielding my weapons and I'm firing both at the same time, I have a chance to regenerate ammo, which is really, really nice for ammo sustain. A common cause of death in this run is to run out of ammo, and if I can avoid that, I might not die. That'd be cool. And I'll talk about steroids now, since I mentioned dual wielding. The reason why this character is just OP for speedrunning is because he can dual wield weapons, which means I can do basically double the DPS of any other character in early game. And by the time he falls off, the run's basically over, so... There is a different route that's found. It's not marathon safe. Ooh, I actually lost my strong spirit there. The palaces, the enemies are slow, but they're incredibly incredibly damaging. The dogs do 6 to me. Any of the orbs on screen, I know you guys like orbs. They do 5 damage to me. And right now I don't have strong spirit, so basically anything that hits me in palace will kill me. That'd be fun if I just died. I would enjoy that a lot.
Another characteristic of steroids is that his accuracy is actually much lower than the other characters. So that one time in the Crystal Caves when his cross bolts were completely missing the spiders in front of him, that wasn't completely his fault.
It was...
Just mostly,
yeah.
We'll call it 90% the game's fault. How about that? It wasn't an AAM, I promise. No NAM.
So there are cops here. They'll be more relevant when we reach loop. But for now, they're just kind of annoyance in palace.
Yeah. I actually took them there because that's an IDPD chest, which whenever I pick it up, it'll give me a lot of ammo. I don't take that, fun as it is. But yeah, the thing with the IDPD chest, they spawn IDPD everywhere. I actually took it here because I also wanted Strong Spirit back. Whenever I get full health, I'll get my spirit back, which means I can survive another fatal hit.
Yeah, only once per level, though.
Only once per level, yeah.
So Strong Spirit is active when he has the halo over his head. So if he doesn't have that over his head, you should be a little scared.
And just for reference, IDPD is Interdimensional Police Department.
All right, so this boss is a namesake of the game. I have to kill these generators in order to enter the loop. If I killed them otherwise, my run would end, and that would be awkward because I haven't fought about half of the bosses in the game. So we finish off these generators first. There we go. And now he's significantly weakened, and I just kind of rain bullets into him until he falls over.
Yeah, so in loop 0, as kind of an assistance, if you kill the generators, the throne loses about half of its health, so it makes the fight a lot faster.
Yeah.
Throne is easily one of the most tanky bosses in the game, actually.
I actually didn't know that it diminished its health by half.
Only for loop 0. Afterwards, it doesn't do anything.
Okay.
I think it might. I'm not sure. Someone in Discord is mad that I don't know. So anyway, Throne 2, this is the first loop boss I have to fight. Basically, the Throne is mad that I killed him earlier, so he's going to fly around. But sadly, he has the same fate.
Yep. If you thought we were going to sit on the Throne, you were...
Not happening this run. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry about that. So anyway, we're in Loop Desert now. As you can see, there's some new enemies here from other areas in the game. And it's significantly more dangerous. And starting now, I will actually get Vans. I'm completely out of ammo. I need to look for a better weapon. But anyways, I'm thinking about that. There's going to be Vans that spawn whenever I kill a certain amount of enemies in a level.
Disgusting gameplay. Disgusting gameplay.
Nah, I'm good. So anyway, they spawn, as you can see, a bunch of IDPD. You'll start to see elite IDPD as well, which are basically buff versions of the IDPD that already exist, and they can all instantly kill me if they feel like it.
Yeah, they all have special effects mimicking some of the early characters in the game. So one of them can shield and teleport, one of them can suck you in and swipe at you with a sword, and one rolls around and shoots rockets.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, all of them are basically, they're the most unpredictable enemies in the game by far.
They're everyone's favorite enemies.
Yeah.
And by favorite, I mean least favorite.
Basically, as soon as a van spawns, it's first priority for me to deal with them. And again, to save some time, I'm going to charge up this vault with reds. It's kind of a little sketchy. There we go. We're in. And that'll skip 1-2.
Yeah, so typically the best way to deal with vans and score runs is to kill it before it can even spawn the IDPD.
Yeah,
that's not feasible right now with this current weapon.
Yeah, my current weapons can't really insta-give a van. It would just be a waste of ammo. The nice thing about vans is they will give me ammo back for killing all the IDPD, which, as you can see, ammo has been pretty sketchy so far.
Yeah, Throne Butt is helping, and if we didn't have that, it would be significantly worse, actually.
So, you probably want Bolt Marrow last, right?
So you remember Big Bandit, right?
Yeah, now there's two of him.
Yeah, we got a second one.
It's no problem now because I have enough DPS to just kind of walk into him until he falls over, and he did, in fact, fall over.
So for each loop, there will actually be two Big Bandits, and because we met the incentive for loop 10, you're going to see 20 Big Bandits spawn later. So.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
Yeah, it's two per loop and one at loop zero.
Yep.
They become on loop the most difficult boss in the game because of how many that spawn.
Arguably.
I would say Bandits are harder than Throne 2.
It's the killer of most score runs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they get so tanky and they become more aggressive, firing more bullets and charging more frequently. And the charge does most of your HP.
So Fish actually picked up his last normal mutation,
okay.
Technically. So it's actually, it was Patience, which means he's going to re-roll it.
Yeah, I'll re-roll in a second.
But he's about to hit level cap. So when you hit level 10, you actually stop leveling, but you still have a rad meter. And that's because there are weapons that use rads as ammo. And, all right, so here's Mom. Probably
this is the scariest part of the run, in my opinion. I'm going to try to just push into her, but she can also just spawn toxic balls, and I can't get in. I don't have any way of dealing with toxic balls. Melee, while it's very good for taking out projectiles, is incredibly slow for speed runs. Okay, we got Mom down. That's good.
There you go.
All right, so she explodes, and now we kind of have to get in there, get this ammo. I did pick up Plutonium Hunger, which will make it easier for me to grab some of this ammo.
Yep.
To talk about some more of my mutations, there's a few okay ones. This is a really defensive build, honestly. Having both Rhino Skin and Strong Spirit is basically all the safety I need.
Yep.
That gives me +4 HP and the survive one fatal hit per level.
You will get 2 rerolls, though, in a sec. We'll talk about those.
Yeah.
And then Bloodlust also gives you a chance of recovering 1 HP when you kill an enemy.
Yeah.
So that's really defensive too.
Yeah, once I get in a loop, that's really nice because there's going to be enemies swarming everywhere.
So I guess a little about the category. All bosses isn't what the most common category, I guess. People usually run any percent, but because you rush through the game so fast, you see almost none of it. Got the rat. But some people would say like the game doesn't really start until you loop and you ultra, because that's really when things start to pick up and become interesting.
Did you double select mutations there?
Yeah, so I was, whenever you get ultra mutations for steroids, I always take Get Loaded. Both of his ultra mutations are not that great. Get Loaded is definitely better. It gives me all ammo types from Yellow Chest, but I was mashing 2 to select it optimally, forgetting that I had a reroll, so I just picked up Open Mind, which is a
very good mutation.
Oh yeah, it's great. We'll go with that.
you make sure you take the Crown Vault on the next level.
Yeah, I need to uncurse. One downside of cursed weapons, if I visit 4-1 with a cursed weapon in my equipment, I will get Cursed Crystal Caves, which have teleporting enemies that will instantly kill me.
And then also the normal Crystal Spiders, they also have a chance of duplicating when you kill them. So sometimes crystals might spawn directly into you, or a whole swarm of enemies will spawn out of nowhere.
It's a really rough area. It has its place in score runs because it lets you level up very quickly in early game. But in late game, you typically want to avoid it.
Yeah.
Don't forget to step on the crown.
Yeah, I need to step on the thing. Thank you for that reminder. I might have forgotten.
Yeah, I was surprised you didn't get rid of it in 1-2.
Yeah, I kind of forgot. It was whatever, though. So anyway, yeah, I had to step on the pedestal there to uncurse my weapon. It's one of the few ways to uncurse again. These Vault Guardians, they fire up these balls. They're incredibly dangerous.
Those can insta-gip you through
anything.
Strong Spirit pretty easily.
I almost took Crown of Blood. That would have been awful.
Crown of Blood spawns more enemies per level, and you get less rads, so it's very good for score runs, not so much, you know, going fast.
Yeah, for speed runs, I would get swarmed and overwhelmed. That would be bad. So anyway, we're at Loop, Big Bandit net, or not
oh,
Big Bandit.
That. There's an E-Shielder.
Yeah, I see him.
Oh, geez.
E-Shielders are bad. I have a Seeker, so I can take him out pretty easily. Let's hide here. All right, teleport away, please. Oh,
Nope. Oh, gosh.
We're fine. I've dealt with this before. We're good.
All right,
see?
All right.
Oh, my gosh.
We're good.
Okay. No big deal.
All right, I'll admit, that was a little scary, yeah.
Yeah, I was clenching there.
All right. So
another loot boss is coming up here, Hyper Crystal. She's kind of just a mob enemy that spawns rotating laser crystals. I just kind of push her down. She's no problem.
Yeah. It's a little bit dangerous because if you touch a crystal, it is a one-shot.
Yeah.
It does 10 HP, though, right?
The regular crystals do 20. Touching Hyper Crystal does 200 damage. 200.
Yeah, for the reference, the max HP you can get on a character is 20 with crystal.
Yeah.
So, you know, 200, a little excessive,
yeah.
They just wanted to make sure.
They wanted to kill you, like, 10 times over, basically.
Yep. Ah, yes. Wonderful. Oh, jeez.
Okay. I'm going to pick up this Devastator to take this out. I can talk about hop swapping. I haven't really had to do it yet this run, but if I pick up a weapon off the floor, it'll have no reload cooldown, so I can just instantly fire it. And combined with Steroid's automatic weapon firing, I can just hold my mouse button and then mash the pickup key. This man needs to die. Thank you.
You got
there's
right?
the ammo.
But yeah, I can just mash the pickup key and hold shoot, and I will just spray shots everywhere because I'm firing every time I pick up the weapon.
So we shot an E-Shielder earlier. Those are incredibly dangerous, but arguably the Elite Inspector we just saw was more dangerous. He pulls you in, and he has an incredibly strong melee attack.
Yeah. So earlier in the run, I got Last
Wish.
Why
didn't you take Gamma Guts?
That's a good question. Why didn't I take Gamma Guts?
You gotta go fast.
So I am in jungle now. I took Last Wish earlier in the run, and this spawns a flower in 5-1 in any loop.
We actually saw it in loop 0.
Yeah, we saw it in loop 0. I chose not to take it. But this takes me to an optional area, which is way easier, way faster than Frozen City. So I will gladly take this little shortcut.
Although in loop 0, it's probably harder, actually.
Yeah, it's harder. In loop 0, it's not guaranteed to be faster. The optimal any percent route. Ooh, that's a plasma cannon. All right, so the optimal any percent route usually does take... What is this?
Oh, okay, that was rough.
The optimal any percent route usually does take pre-whoop jungle.
But it's a gamble.
It's 100% a gamble.
Basically, any percent in this game, there's no such thing as safety. You run basically into everything and hope you don't die.
Yeah, you just push.
That's so Hunter's scary just because he's a distraction from everything else, really.
Mm-hmm.
He dies very quickly. He actually barely has more HP than Big Bandit.
Yeah.
He's already down.
Oh.
But if you haven't noticed, this plasma cannon gun is pretty good.
Yeah, this is probably second best weapon for speedrunning, in my opinion. Basically, it fires a plasma orb that splits into 4 or 8 more balls. And it has ridiculous cloud clearing abilities and has great single target damage. It's one of the highest single target weapons.
I think... You don't have Scarier, but if you had Scarier, you could actually one-shot a van with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we will be seeing its upgraded version in the Loop 10 show.
Yeah, we'll see that in a second.
If you think this is good, well...
Yeah.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
All right, so we're in the final area. The final main progression area we're going to visit. It has the Technomancer.
Wait, where's the title card? Oh, there it is.
It's there.
There we go.
I needed to think for a second. But entering a van instantly kills all enemies in a level, which includes the boss. So, see you, Technomancer.
We couldn't do this earlier because you can get back out, but you can't get back in a second time.
Yeah,
you can. That recently, actually.
Yeah, you can only enter a van once per level. Otherwise, there's ways to infinitely farm kills.
Yes. However, we are not going to be leaving because there is a boss at the end of this.
Yeah, this is the final boss in the run coming up after I clear out the HQ. This is the police headquarters. It has all the IDPD in the game.
Yeah, there's some lore about them wanting to kill you because you're freaks. And I don't know why the police wants to kill you.
There's a very complex lore that's hard to understand for this game. So not many of us are well-versed.
As you can see, the elite... elite cops can just spawn here. So it can be really, yeah.
Oh, I have a cluster spawn of elite grunts. Okay, right. One died.
Yeah. Good. And those things, whenever you're behind a wall or you're between a wall and them, they will shoot missiles at your location.
If they lose line of sight.
Kill you.
Yeah. The missiles are pretty huge explosion radius. They cannot be reacted to. Like, it's inhumanly possible to react to them.
The plasma balls from the E-Shielder actually do 10 each, by the way, so it's very easy to just get melted by an E-Shielder.
All right, so this is the final boss I'm going to fight right here, Captain. And hopefully she sprays bullets, but she's really not a threat. She's just kind of tanky. Hopefully I can deal with her pretty fast.
The worst case scenario is running out of ammo before the boss dies, because you just kind of have to wait.
Yeah, those big balls of bullets that she shoots, those drop ammo. But probably the most dangerous thing that Captain can do is, if you see Captain can warp around, there is a chance that Captain will spawn right on top of you and do a ton of damage.
I think she tries to avoid to do that, but she does charge into you, which is 10 damage. How is she still alive? Jeez.
Oh, my word.
Okay, we got her.
Oh, man.
All right, let's finish her off with style with this golden grenade launcher. Got her.
Nice.
All right, and that's going to be time coming up now. Time.
Not too bad. I mean, the mutation pool wasn't that quick.
I couldn't really play as offensive as I wanted to. I got a whole bunch of defensive mutations, but it went pretty well, I think.
Call it marathon safety.
Right. We'll call it marathon safety,
Like, for the record, there's a mutation that reduces the health of every enemy by 20%, which is just honestly insane and kind of required, I'd say, at some points.
Yeah, I'd say 20% decrease for everything, so it's ridiculous for speedrunning. The main bottleneck of this run is killing enemies as fast as you can. They have 20% less HP.
Alright.
Alright, so I'm going to switch over to NTT now. It's a modded client for this game that'll let me show off the Loop 10 Showcase.
Alright. Yeah, and you know, some would say Loop 10 is where the game really, really starts.
Yeah, this is why I play the game right here.
If you're one of maybe, like, you know, 15, 20 people.
Like, when my run got accepted to GDQ, I was like, oh, that's cool. I'm playing all bosses at GDQ. And then the Loop 10 incentive got met, and I was like, oh, boy, this is going to be fun.
Yep. Most people for this game do not speedrun it. Speedrunning is kind of janky in this game.
It's a lot of RNG, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, the whole game is a lot of RNG, to be fair.
But you can mitigate it more over a long run.
Yeah.
Give me 1 second for setup. This is kind of janky right now.
Okay, take your time.
Yeah, sorry.
So the character he's going to be playing is Eyes this time. Eyes is a pretty good score run character. His active ability is when you right-click, enemies are drawn towards you and bullets are pushed away. And he has an ultra where if you're not holding right-click, enemies are pushed away. So it's super powerful for grouping up enemies and crowd control. And his passive is even better. You see better in the dark.
I was ready to pull off the headphones just in case it got really loud, because this game is very loud on startup.
Yeah, a lot of indie games seem to do that. I don't know why. All right.
All right. I think I'm...
Yeah, so this is a really cool mod. It lets you play with your friends, and co-op is so much fun, honestly.
Yeah, it was made by Yellow Afterlife. He's done a ton of work modding this game, making a modding API. It's wonderful. Shout-outs to him, and shout-outs to Rescue Media as well.
Yep.
All right, so I think I have my mod set up. Let me check real fast. Okay. I'm going to, first, before I start this run, do a little explanation, but...
So, he's just setting up. He loaded a mod that will start him in Loop 10 instead of, you know, at the start of the game, because it'll take 3 hours to get there.
And that's the thing about score runs. Basically, every time I kill a throne, I loop, and after a while, that starts taking, like, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. And so, eventually, that would take about 3 hours total to reach Loop 10. And I think GDQ likes me, but I don't think they would be happy with me playing for 3 hours. So, not yet, at least. All right. So anyway.
So this is actually a secret area you can normally get to in the game as YV. When YV ultras, he gets to go here. And it's actually very screwy with the game's code. But we're just spawning here just so, you know, we have a nice selection of weapons.
Yeah, this is a nice little hub area for me to start out and start my explanation of the run. So basically, this is what you donated for, Loop 10 Showcase. I'm going to be showing you one main progression area, which includes the boss, and then I'll show you one final area in sewers, which includes another boss. So two bosses, four areas total.
Yeah, so like, I mean, just to explain, the areas, I mean, alternate. You get a progression area of three of the same level, and then you get one level.
Yeah, so one kind of side area.
You get three levels of desert, one level of sewers, three levels of scrapyard, one level of...
Yeah, et cetera.
Yeah, so on and so forth.
All right, so to explain my build real fast, I've loaded into a mod that'll start me off on loop 10. I've gotten more or less, not exactly optimal, but eight good mutations, and they are in order. Strong Spirit, this will prevent my death once per level, and as it says, it recharges full HP in the next area, so basically I can take one fatal hit per run, or per level. Jeez, I keep saying that. Trigger Fingers, every time I kill an enemy, I'll lower my reload time for both weapons. Long Arms, which increases melee range. Scarier Face, 20% less HP for enemies. Plus 4 max HP with Rhino Skin. Stress, whenever I get low HP, I shoot faster in general. Plutonium Hunger, drags and drops from further away. And Bloodlust, which every time I kill an enemy, I have a pretty high chance of getting 1 HP back. And basically this build is centered around, there's going to be a lot of enemies. And so these are all mutations that scale very, very well with that. And they also work very well with my weapons. And to talk about these weapons real fast. So this is a super plasma cannon. You saw my plasma cannon last run. Well, this fires four of those. I'll just give it a shot. It destroys absolutely everything. And I just realized I need to turn up my game audio a tiny bit. Oh no, you can hear. Okay, hold on. Let me just mute this for a sec. There's YV crying. I forgot about that. So, and I also have the Ultra Shovel. This is basically my defensive wall. All melee swings will reflect projectiles and kill small enemies really easily. It's very high DPS, very defensive, and very, very good.
It's essentially the best weapon in the game.
Yeah.
Or the Super Plasma.
Yeah.
Plus or minus. These are the two best.
That's all that matters. These are the two best.
To emphasize its importance, Trigger Fingers, the mutation is literally the only reason that Super Plasma Cannon works.
Yeah, because it has like a 10-plus second reload, so...
Yeah, Trigger Fingers literally allows you to spam that because you're just shooting a massive ball into hordes of enemies, and so the reload is constantly getting lowered, and so it allows you to spam it, even though it's supposed to be like a higher Sky Reward weapon. Yeah.
All right, get ready for chaos.
Do we have a timer for this? I don't know, but I guess I'll count down 3, 2, 1, go again, because you guys liked that last time, didn't you? All right. 3, 2, 1. All right.
I hope you like the color green.
Yeah. Epilepsy warning, by the way, because this game gets really ridiculous. Every time I loop, there's more enemies on screen, and they get more HP, and those enemies fire bullets, and those enemies split into other enemies, and it gets insanely chaotic.
So for the record, this is only loop 10. Global record right now is loop 18.
Yeah, my PB is loop 17, and it took me about 8 hours with a few breaks.
So a couple core mechanics of looping. An additional van spawns per loop. So loop 10 will have 10 vans spawning in, and at loop 3 and beyond, they explode when they come in. And at loop 3 as well, you don't get any more elite cops. Instead, these IDPD freaks spawn.
Yes.
And they have these spray of bullets in front of them, and they actually drop rads as opposed to normal cops.
Yeah.
So they and the vans, which drop a lot of rads, loop 3 and beyond, are one reason why we were able to actually do these deep loop runs at all.
So, you can see the importance of melee, I'm just saying, because they destroy the bullets, some of the shots, and deflect some of the other ones. Just imagine trying this without a melee weapon. It's something else.
Yeah, the record with no melee is loop 10-01, and it was a slog.
That was you, right?
Yeah, I got that a month or so ago, and it was quite the grind. Anyway, enough of that.
This is the key level here.
Yeah,
bandits are so hard here.
Yeah, so like we said earlier, we're going to get 20 big bandits here, and they all are incredibly tanky and incredibly spammy. So here, I want to try to clear an area for them to safely spawn in.
Oh,
all right, and then I want to push as hard as I can with bullets behind me. And I need... Oh, okay, I got my spirit. We're fine. All right, and I want to clear the level so that all the vans are running over everything behind me.
You should be safe now, at least.
Yeah, we're good now.
Yeah, so and using the super... So I know he has a shovel, but the super plasma cannon is way better digging.
Yeah, the shovel does not dig. The super plasma cannon does. Funny how that works. And now we're in the cleanup phase of big manets. They very aggressively charge into me.
Yeah, when they don't have line of sight on you, they will charge at you. And, oh,
that's
there's...
Dang. Oh, this sucks. All right, I can just go in again real fast.
It shouldn't take too long.
Yeah.
All right.
Man, I got that every time in practice. Sad.
All right. I was going to explain something about the shovel or melee weapons in general and a few charging enemies. This used to work, I think, for multiple enemies, but there was a patch that changed it to just working with the big, like, rad dogs that you saw in the palace area, Area 7. But when those... enemies like the big bandit or the dogs, when they jump at you or charge at you, if you swing a melee weapon, you essentially can multi-hit them. Is it like once every frame then?
Yeah, it's once every frame, I believe. So.
And this is a 30 FPS game, so that can do a lot of damage to them. And given how tanky those dogs and the bandits get, the deeper loop you go, everything increases in HP by a ton, especially like the bosses.
Yeah.
So that is a way that we are able to actually take out those bandits. So taking cover and manipulating the AI to charge at you is a way that we can actually take them out in a reasonable amount of time.
Yeah. So the freaks, and I'm not talking about the ones on the couch with me, but
hey, that's
the
cold.
Freaks. The freaks are actually, so they were meant to just destroy you because of how many bullets they shoot, and they can actually drop live grenades on death, which is part of all the explosions.
Yeah.
But they're actually kind of a blessing because they drop a huge amount of rads and drops, and you can actually use them to refill on tough fights like Throne 2. Or, and when the vans spawn in, they actually explode starting from loop 3.
Yeah.
So they just drop a bunch of goodies and deliver them right to your...
Yeah, the funny thing about the IDPD freaks, they were supposed to be the hard wall of the game. Like, the devs were like, oh yeah, no way the players can get past this. They make the game easier.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you cannot sustain this ultra shovel I am swinging constantly.
Yeah, if the vans just spawned elites after loop 3,
it would be way
harder. It would be significantly harder.
Oh yeah.
To progress.
So yeah, we mentioned that the ultra weapons, while they're not good for speed runs, they're very good at loop and beyond. Now, because of how many enemies are spawning and the rads they drop at this point, you can see that his rad meter in the top left is going down little by little, but because of how many rads spawn... Okay, yeah, you should be able to dig there just fine.
Yeah.
Rads aren't really an issue, especially loop 3 and beyond.
Yep.
Loops 1 and 2... A
it's
good player will be able to maintain that pretty well, but it is a little more sketchy to keep your rad counter at a safe enough level.
And the thing about loop 1 and 2 is the normal cops don't drop any rads. So if you swing your ultra shovel, you know, 8 times to clear out the cops, you're going to be really low on rads and...
Okay,
you need
there
it for
are the bandits. I was wondering where they were.
I don't know how they ended up there.
Yeah, so the big thing is just kind of keeping your back to the wall, because the shovel, obviously, it clears out almost everything in front of you and to the side, but you can get shot in the back real easily.
Yeah, and standing between a wall and a bandit baits them into charging you, which makes them easier to kill.
Yeah, this might look sketchier than it actually is, but this is going pretty decently right now.
Yeah, like, the cleanup is usually the safest part by far of bandits. Of course, that's what I ended up dying on, but it is what it is.
Yep.
But yeah, that another reason that these loop runs are possible, because some of these levels might extend a long time, is because the freaks do start respawning at a certain point. They do start regenerating.
Every 30 seconds of in-game time, they respawn.
That's actually supposed to hurt you more, but actually, again, it's a little bit helpful.
Well, especially on a level like this, when you might be swinging your shoe shovel a lot, so you might be running out of rads, this allows you to keep on swinging and not... like, run out of rads and therefore not able to swing, like, basically your most important weapon at this point.
All right. I have a few bandits left. There's a sound cue whenever I kill them all. No, it's still going. There's wait. I think that was it, maybe?
Yeah, sounds like it. Just...
All right, that was it. All right. Just clean up the freaks.
Nice.
And we're into the...
The loop sewers. And
sewers.
I know you guys saw Mom earlier. A little briefly, she died pretty fast. But she wasn't that quick on her feet, you know. She's a big lady. But she's got some sneakers now, and
she got Nikes or something, because she's doing around everywhere.
Her movement speed increases every loop, and essentially later on she becomes Sonic.
Yeah.
And sometimes you can't even react well to how fast she's moving at you, and that's a way that she can easily drop your strong spirit.
Yeah, she does
with
10 contact damage, which is ridiculous amount.
And the other thing that makes this fight kind of interesting is that the SPC is not very effective on her, unlike many other bosses.
Ooh. That was a little bit scary.
If you shoot the SPC, it just bounces off her and she just runs away.
Yeah, she's just like, see, I don't care about
typically,
her.
Typically, oh, jeez.
There she is, yep.
Okay, and this is actually one of the few places in Loop where another weapon is, like, very beneficial to pick up because weapons with, like, high fire rate and high
you can actually
projectile
pin her down.
Speed
yeah.
will actually be able to damage her more consistently.
Yep.
So something like the incinerator that he's picked up is okay, but...
Yeah, I'm looking for something better currently.
Yeah,
I have to fight some
bread food. Is kind of... That might be okay, but...
Supercross was great. Okay, there we go.
Oh, yeah.
She's, yeah, she just wants a hug sometimes. She's very unpredictable.
So the SPC is actually only really strong on bosses because a lot of the bosses will absorb the entire shot. And in that case, they actually absorb all the smaller shots as well. And
there we go. Okay.
You're good.
All right. And once I finish off this wave of freaks, that'll end my incentive.
Action. Or if an explosion hits the... Yep. There we go.
All right, we'll finish it off in pizza sewers. There it is. That's the Loop 10 Showcase.
All right. Yeah. You were scaring me so many times there.
Yeah, that was a little scary. Yeah, thanks to everyone who donated for this.
Yep.
Like I said, score running is my favorite part of this game. It's why I've invested a ton of time into it. It's a lot like speed running, where we just share a bunch of strats that we found to deal with bosses effectively. It's a lot of fun.
And complain.
Yeah, and complain.
Oh, yeah.
That's the best part, though. Yeah, so shout-outs again to the community. Thanks, everyone, for watching, and shout-outs to Archie. That's all I got. Thanks for watching.
All right.
Thank you so much, Fish McMuffins, for your amazing run. All right, now we are coming up on the StarCraft Remastered deadline. We have $37,807.82, but that is for $60,000 as the amount we need to hit. So let's go ahead and get donations in for that. We have a $400 from Private Meta. Use these 400 minerals to build a nexus. Run fast for a better world. And we have an anonymous $500 donation. And that was with no comment. Thank you for donating. And we are now going to go to an ad break.
Straight for the bomb here.
Assault with long range.
If we can get crossfire in the arcade, we can actually take it.
Don't stand that close to the.
That was me.
How did that happen?
I'm aware it was you.
Here, watch this.
Yeah, okay, Vince, are you covering me?
Kind of.
All right, I got him.
South by window, he's lit.
Oh my god, we did it! Yeah, we did it!
How many years have I waited for the Warrior of Light?
Rated T for teen.
Heave-ho tasks up to four players with a simple goal. Don't fall to your death. Players will use their own two hands and the outstretched grip of their friends to grapple across each level on their way to victory. Coming to Nintendo Switch and Steam this summer. All right, and we are ready for the StarCraft Brood War interview with Jhobz and KingDime. Take it away.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jhobz, and I am joined by KingDime, who's going to be, hopefully, running StarCraft Brood War later. Be sure, like, again, that is a bonus game, so please be sure to get those donations in, because we still are a little bit off that $60,000 mark. And without that, we won't get to see your run. And I got a lot of awesome questions about your run, so I want to learn more about it. So thank you for joining me, first of all, KingDime.
No problem. It's great to be back in another GDQ. This is probably in my... about my 10th by now. It's 2014.
Yeah, so we kind of know you as a Doom runner. What is it about StarCraft that made you want to jump on that train?
Well, I'm just thinking way back in the day, in the days of Wolf 3D and Doom 1, there was a game that I played before that, which I was so excited about, called Dune 2 from Westwood. So that was kind of my start in RTS. And then eventually I received StarCraft 1 on Christmas in 1999. I remember getting the gift and opening it with my brother and just giving him a big high five. And then with all my schoolmates, we went on Battle.net and just started doing use map settings games like Helm's Deep, Snowball Wars, and so on and so forth.
Did you ever try to, like, get it working on school computers and stuff, playing it at school?
I didn't quite get there. No. It was more chips challenge at school.
Well, I wanted to ask, so you're running the Protoss campaign. If the run gets in, we really hope it does. What is it about Protoss that you like for the speed run?
The Protoss campaign, it's the fastest of the six. There's just a lot of ways to break the game, and it's specifically the Protoss expansion campaign in Brood War, and also in RTS, like, it's kind of dependent on some of the map triggers if you can end the map. So in the very first original Terran campaign, there's 8 or 9 maps, which are efficient. You can do breaks and you can do everything, but there's a 30-minute auto-scroller. So right away it's like, nope. So it was kind of analyzing the mission, seeing what would be interesting to the audience, and seeing if it flowed well.
Okay. And Protoss was always my favorite for StarCraft 2. I haven't touched much of Brood War myself, but so I'm excited to watch it for that reason. What is, like, one moment for somebody who doesn't know anything about StarCraft, right? They don't know anything about StarCraft or RTSs, maybe much in general. What's one moment, what one point in the timer that somebody can look forward to for your run?
I'm thinking on the final mission called Countdown, because we're going to be doing the defense of the entire Protoss race against the Swarm, the Zerg, and it's going to get absolutely crazy at the end with Guardians, Defilers, Dark Swarms, and just everything heading on in to finish us off. But we're going to try not to let them do that.
Great. So right near the end, like 50-ish, like something like that, minutes. Awesome. So that's what you got to look forward to. Obviously, you're going to want to watch the whole thing, but that's the big button moment. I do want to jump into some social media questions, because we had some people out there who are big fans of StarCraft. We have one from at LJP7373, who asks, as someone who's never played StarCraft and they would like to, how should they start? Is any single game better than one another for a beginner? And I'll say even, is any campaign better than another one for starting out?
I would recommend going in order, because that's just how you're taught. You start with the Terran campaign and you're kind of figuring things out. But A game like StarCraft is a little bit complicated, but if you learn your hotkeys, mm-hmm. learn how to use control groups, there are also camera hotkeys that you can use, you'll start to get a hang of it, and it'll really help you down the line as you get to the harder campaigns, because Brood War is, it's a big step up from the original, but mm-hmm. if you know how to use hotkeys and all that, I think you'll be golden.
Cool. So are there any resources out there maybe that that somebody who's new to it, or maybe they want to jump into speedrunning the game but not, but they've been playing it for a while. Is there any resources out there that people might not know about?
There's loads for a competitive game like StarCraft. There's the main StarCraft hub is called Team Liquid, which now I think you can get to it just by tl.net if you write that in. There's the StarCraft Reddit, r/StarCraft. And there's multiple Discords that you can use, but the ones I recommend is checking out for the Coaches Pupil League. Mm-hmm. And there's a L Masters Discord for beginners. And then you can use those and then fork off to more advanced strategies.
Right. Okay, great. I do want to ask one more social media question before I let you go, because I'm going to kind of morph it a little bit. This is from at KT Colangelo, which is a fant over there at our interview production desk, asking, Brood War has been a staple of the esports scene since the early 2000s. Have professional players influenced you at all in terms of strategy or micro when it comes to the speedrun? And even just in general, has multiplayer play helped you in the speedrun in ways that you might not have expected?
Oh, in multiplayer, we've done the game to death in the sense that there's many strategies that have been learned over there. And an example of one of them is you can do mutaboxing by abusing the magic box, where if you have an overlord in the corner of the map and you have a group of mutas, you can clump them up and do very cool patrol micro, especially against the Terran race, and you're going to see an example of that, but with scouts.
Okay. Yeah. So it's cool to see the kind of two communities really having a lot of crossover there.
Yeah.
Well, KingDime, thank you very much for joining me, and I really hope that we get to see that run. Remember, everybody, get those donations in, because StarCraft Brood War is a bonus game. We still got to make that happen before we'll be able to see it right after Command & Conquer Red Alert 3. But we'll go ahead and get set up with that one now by Railcoon and Cover Muffin, because they are just about ready to go.
Thank you, Jhobz, and thank you, KingDime, for that fantastic interview. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the real-time strategy block of Summer Game Stunt Quick 2019. We are live on Twitch, powered by Twitch, raising money in support of Doctors Without Borders. Up next is the Red Alert 3 with Railcoon and Cover Muffin. But first, I want to make a case for you guys out there in the audience, in chat, and just watching to donate for StarCraft Brood War. We are nearly $40,000. We have so much ground to cover, but we have so much time to do it. Not only is this the first time that Brood War will be featured in SGDQ, not only is this the beautiful HD remaster, not only does KingDime have a super thrilling route through it that will leave you on the edge of your seat, but most importantly, fun fact in StarCraft, when you click on a probe, it makes a cute little robot cat sound. I'm not joking. When you click on it, it goes meow. So if you want to hear a bunch of beautiful little cute cat sounds, get your donations towards it. While I let you mull that over, let me play a quick tad chat. We'll be right back. Hey there, everybody. Welcome back to Summer Games Done Quick 2019. We have Red Alert 3 setting up right now, but first, a $15 donation from Xanoff. He says, for the Horde! Oh, wait. Wrong game? Let's Zerg rush that incentive. Thank you so much, Xanoff. We have $50 from Tricycle Spider. He says, for the sake of ire and for the great cause, I simply had to donate. GDQs are great events. Love watching it as much as I can. Good luck to all the runners. $75, thanks to G. Chris. He says, super excited to see the Red Alert 3 with the cutscenes, as they are brilliant. Putting this towards StarCraft so that it can hopefully follow Red Alert. Ladies and gentlemen, we are on track. We are nearly up to $40,000 on it. Thank you so much. Keep on donating. Show some love. Yo, shout-outs to all my fans and all the love for the Zerg Race. $25 from Isnan1313 says, StarCraft is still one of the best RTS games out there. But Protoss, really? For the Swarm! Thank you. TAC sends us $50. They say, planned my entire afternoon around getting a chance to see the Red Alert 3 run. Hey, me too, but of course I'm the host, so. Donating for cutscene percent and the StarCraft incentive. Thank you. Thank you so much. $250 comes to us from Peter86. He says, we require additional pylons. Thank you. Yeah, let's get that Psy in. Let's get those donations in. Mr. Kenny chimes in with a $25 donation and a really good idea. He says, hey, SGDQ, let the donation train start like a zergling rush for StarCraft. We need more donations. Thank you so much. Yeah, let's see that donation train come in. Oh, man. Ladies and gentlemen, we were nearly over $41,000. We are getting super, super close with every single donation. Like this one. Eggsy sends us $50. He says, we really need to get those Dragoons to take a bath. Good luck, Railcoon and Cover Muffin. And let's make SCBW happen. Thank you. Anonymous sends a $25 donation. He says, let's make StarCraft happen. Game is too good to skip. Go Protoss. Yes, indeedy. Thank you, Anonymous.